morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all once again this bright Sabbath morning. Before we get into our service, we will be singing a few songs. Our first hymn of choice is hymn number 202, Hail Him, the King of Glory, 202. Next hymn will be hymn number 206, Face to Face with Christ My Savior.
Face to face with Christ my Savior.
song will be hymn number 218, When He Cometh, When He Cometh. Hymn number 524, 524, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Trust Him more, God's salvation. As we remain standing, if you have Bibles, please turn with me to the book of Jonah, chapter 4, verses 8 onwards. The book of Jonah says, "And it came to pass, when the sun did arise, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat upon the head of Jonah, that he fainted and wished in himself to die, and said, It is better for me to die than to live. And God said to Jonah, Dost thou well to be angry for the God? And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then said the Lord, Thou hast had pity on me, the God for which thou hast not labored, neither madest it grow, which came up in a night and perished in a night. And should not I spare Nineveh, that great city wherein are more than 60,000 persons that cannot discern between their right hand and their left hand, and also much cattle?" As we understand, we are in the situation of this pandemic. We all are in chaos condition. Though God had made it a privilege for us to be a witness, to listen to His words in His presence, in the house of prayer, I hope and trust this morning's message will touch our hearts, make us to understand how God cares for you all. Let's pray. Merciful, gracious, loving and living Heavenly Father, You have created us in Your image with love, and Your intention was good on humanity. Loving Father in heaven, we understand from the scriptures, when Satan entered into this world, he introduced in the humanity pain, suffering, death, pestilence. Father God, we know ultimately that You are in control. It's a privilege, and we are glad this morning, we the children, to be in Your presence, to worship You. Father God, we want to thank You as a family for investing the breath of life in us. Without You, O Lord, it was not possible for us to see this moment. Loving God in heaven, as Your children are watching online, and as the believers are present here to worship You, may we all glorify Your wonderful name. May we dedicate our hearts and our souls to Thee. We are in these last days. Satan is eager and tempting us in from all the sides. But I know, dear God in heaven, when we are connected to You, nothing can disturb us. In the name of Jesus this morning, O Lord, we come to You, submitting our lives. May Your will be done. In a special way, O Lord, we want to remember this sequence. Pastor Joseph Mahadeo, Mr. Kiran, and entire family, and also, dear God in heaven, Pastor Shekhar Phillips undergone a surgery, and the people who are not doing so fine. Especially we pray for Geeta, she's not well. They are taking her to hospital, O Lord, at this moment. May You be close to her, O Lord. Extend Your mercies in the name of Jesus. Touch them, dear Father. Sustain them completely. Heal them, O Lord. May they rejoice in Your holy name. that we may all receive the blessings of this Sabbath. As we spend a few minutes in your presence, Lord, may we all draw our hearts closer to you. Forgive us from our sins. I ask these mercies in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Before we could go to the special song and the message, it's an earnest request to the members of the church, wherever you are, may you uphold the people who are in need of our prayers at this moment. I know the whole world is distant, and you need to remember that God will intervene in this condition of pandemic so that God will take complete control over the situation. And especially our Metro Conference President, Pastor Joseph Mahadev, is very sick, and Pastor Shekhar Phillips undergone a surgery and he's doing fine. And Mr. Kiran and the entire family is sick. And recently, last week, he lost his father. May you uphold this family in your personal prayers and family prayers. And one by name Geeta is also very sick. I would like to earnestly request all of you so that prayer brings healing and gives a great change in our lives. Prayer has power. May the good Lord continue to be close to all of us and our family members. At this moment, I would like to invite Elder Wilson to come and render us a special number before we could go to the message.
Happy Sabbath. Praise God. என் இயேசுவே உன்னை நான் மறவேன் மறவேன் என்னாலும் முன்னருளை நான் பாடி மகிழ்ந்திருப்பேன் என் இயேசுவே உன்னை நான் மறவேன் மறவேன் உன் நாமம் என் வாயல் நல் தேனாயினைக்கின்றது உன் வாழ்வு என்னாலும் நல் செய்தியாய் ஜொலிக்கின்றது உன் அன்பை நாளும் என்றும் போது ஆனந்தம் பிறக்கின்றது என் இயேசுவே உன்னை நான் மறவேன் மறவேன் உன் நெஞ்சின் கனவுகளை நிறைவேற்றும் நான் உண்மை உறவாகும் பாலும் உண்மை நாளும் ஆனந்தம் பிறக்கின்றது என் இயேசுவே உன்னை நான் மறவேன் மறவேன் என்னாலும் முன்னருளை நான் பாடி மகிழிருப்பேன் என் இயேசுவே உன்னை நான் மறவேன் மறவேன்
So this morning, it's a wonderful privilege, after a long gap of time, few people are here in the presence of God. There is a special blessings in it when we come into His temple. As David experienced singing, praising God in His temple, gave him a great strength, rejoice in his life, where he shared in the book of Psalms. So before I would like to share the pulpit, I would like to say a few words about Brother Derek. Though his profession is very different, but a very good Bible student and a simple person and always willing to do God's ministry. And he has a habit of always praying for people. And he has his own group which is connected to union office. And he works for union. And as he leads his prayer team in union office, may the good Lord bless him as he delivers a message to all of us. And we are cutting short the time, and the offering will be collected at the end. So we'll try to adopt ourselves to the situations. So kindly cooperate, and if there is any inconvenience from us, we ask you to pardon us and try to adjust and be part of this church, so that it's a family where we need to get adjusted to the situations. But I am glad this morning to welcome all of you for this divine hour. I would like to share the pulpit at this moment to Brother Derek Servan.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Never did we imagine we would worship the Lord in this fashion, but nevertheless, God has brought us to His place of worship. I believe that wherever people are gathered, that becomes a place of worship. We have experienced that for 200 days. I think today is the 200th day of pandemic in India, as we are all quarantined, worshiping the Lord at our dwelling place. And I believe anywhere we gather, it becomes a place of worship. And I believe that after 200 days, you have gathered here together as believers in Christ to worship God. There's nothing like the Sabbath day, I tell you. We are so blessed to have this truth, and we are keeping the Sabbath, and the Sabbath is a delight. One thing I'm missing is the children who will be sitting, and the cheerful faces and their cheerful voice. I know all of you might be missing them. Soon we will all have the opportunity to worship together. If not here, if it's not possible here, we know one place that we will do it, and that's in the eternal kingdom, right? That's one place where no one can stop us from praising God. Before we could get into today's sermon, let's offer a word of prayer. Eternal God, merciful Father, we come to your throne of grace right now, Lord. As I'm going to deliver the message, dear Father, it's not me that your children have come to listen. They have come to hear your word. May I be humbled, and may you speak through me, that when they leave this place of worship, they leave with the blessings that you have for them. May the Holy Spirit hover around here, and also the viewers that are viewing us through YouTube. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to worship you again on the Sabbath day. For I ask all these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a humble request. Keep your Bibles in your hand. Have your cell phones if you don't have your Bibles. Don't social distance from God's word. So I humbly request you to keep your Bibles with you. If you don't have your digital form, your phones also, everyone, not one should be sitting idle here. We're going to go through the book, the chapters of Jonah, and I have a beautiful lesson that we can take along with us today. I hope that you all have your Bibles, and also the brothers and sisters that are viewing us on YouTube, even you, take your Bibles, if not take your devices, and keep the book of Jonah open. God has a wonderful lesson today. My sermon is entitled, Which Jonah Are You? So we have four chapters, and each chapter there's one kind of Jonah that we're going to see. You can put yourself into which Jonah you fit in and how you can relate your life to God's work. Let's turn our attention to the first chapter of Jonah. Jonah has four chapters, and verse 1 of chapter 1 says this: Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. God is calling Jonah and he's saying, come on, rise up. That is a city that is completely wicked. I need you to go to that place. Verse 3, But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof, and went down into it, to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. So we see Jonah's smart like most of our people. When we call them to do God's work, they're very smart. They have an automatic reason to say, I have cough. I'm not worthy enough to share God's word. I'm not better. There are better people than me. Immediate answers we have. It's spontaneous. You don't even have to think. Like, you know, when you keep your hand on the fire and suddenly you release your hand, right? Most of God's children are in this category. They have immediate reasons to give an escape, right? That's what Jonah did. He was so smart that he thought he can escape from the presence of God. He himself knows you can't hide anywhere. And he's doing the most brilliant thing that you could do. He's going in the right opposite direction of where God told him to go. Verse 4 says, But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God, and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea, to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. The first kind of Jonah that I'm going to talk about is sleeping Jonah. When the world is struggling and blinking, what is going on? There are many Christians who fall in this first category, sleeping Jonah. Let anything happen, I don't mind, let's sleep. I don't know what is going on in the world. Why is pandemic? Why there is suffering? Why people are struggling? I don't care. It's okay. Let me be calm. Let me be silent. Let me not share God's word. There's someone out there to share it. Are we in this first category, sleeping Jonas? I just want you to think, this sermon is more of a burden that we as Adventist Christians have to embark and understand where we are in our spiritual lives. Are we sleeping Jonas? Think about it. God is calling us. We are saying, I'm not ready, I'm not worthy, I'm not convicted of the Holy Spirit, I'm not ready to tell anything about Jesus. I'd rather go sleep, spiritual sleeping. And as the verses go by, so the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, What meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God. If so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. So the man is saying, hey, get up from your sleep. What are you doing? We're all struggling and you're sleeping happily. This is what is going on in the world right now. All are crying, pandemic, pandemic, pandemic. We are stuck. There's no job. There's no food. There's no tomorrow. We Christians are like, yes, we know. It is mentioned in Matthew. Everyone suffer. Well, we have to be sharing God's word. We are doing the sleeping work, and world is telling, I don't know what is going on. Get up. Call out your God. Jonah is still sleeping. Where? Not on the first deck. He went to the lowest deck possible where people will not disturb him. Right? That's what most of us try to do. Try to be in our safe zones, our comfort zones, where no one can pull us out. Oh, okay, he's there. Okay, he's Christian. Okay, fine, that's enough. Let's leave him alone. Verse 7, And they said, Everyone to his fellow, come and let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. So they cast lots, and then that fell upon Jonah. How many of you have heard that chant, go Corona, go Corona, go? How many of you took your utensils and went banging crazy on that Sunday? How many of you lit your candles on that one Sunday? How many of you were clapping and for no reason, and flowers were now showered upon those nurses? You find it silly. People are not understanding why this struggle is on them. We as Christians know why it is, and we are still sleeping. The world has opened temples for Corona. I heard in Kerala they have opened a temple for Corona, and the god is Corona. That image that you see with that spiky thing is the idol that is placed in the temple, and people are sending request for prasadam to come from that temple to their homes. The fear of Corona is so much that people are falling at the feet of that virus and saying, please let go of us. Go Corona, Corona go. You might find it funny. You know why it's funny? We didn't share Jesus to them. If you share Jesus to them, they will not go to their Corona, they will go to Jesus. Right? So many ridiculous things are happening in this world. Why is it happening? Because Christians are sleeping. In particular, Seventh-day Adventists are sleeping. If we do not share the light, the darkness will only increase. Right? The more and more people go crazy at homes, they're going to do the weirdest things possible. Like I said, banging that utensil did not do anything, it only increased it more. Right? Shouting out, and I don't know what, you might have been a part of those silliness as well. Why? Simply because, like Jonah, I have nothing to do with this. Me, my family is safe. I have enough of sanitizers at home, enough of masks. I have the food that will last me for another 2 years. Why bother? I'll come on Zoom or I'll come on YouTube at that particular time. I'll sit, I'll wear good clothing, I'll give my offerings right on time. My dear believers, God is not interested in that. He's interested in you. Without you, what will that kingdom be? Empty. God is calling us not to be like that sleeping Jonahs who are, oh, it's good, let's just sleep and, you know, just cross our days and go, no one is going to bother about me. If I'm missing, who is going to bother? I'll just put myself online and I'll do whatever I want to do. No one is going to know anything. Just like at the time of Jonah, they did not know what to do. They started casting lots. Let us find out someone, the other way we'll find this culprit. Well, they did find, in verse 8 it says, then they said unto him, tell us, we pray thee, for whose cause this evil is upon us? What is thine occupation? And whence comest thou? What is thy country? And of what people art thou? The fear forced these people to question him. We are going to be questioned the same way. Who are you? Where are you from? What are you? What is your profession? Why is this struggle on us? This is one of the saddest part, verse 9. And he said unto them, I am a Hebrew, I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. Most of the time, people have to slap us open and say, who are you? Then, I'm a Christian. This is our spiritual experience. People have to literally wake us and ask us who we are. Back in the time of when the early Christians were formed, they could see and understand that they were Christians. Right now, we have to hold boards and say, I am a Christian. I am a Christian. Right? We have to open our mouths and say that we are Christians. Such a pathetic state. Why? We are like that Jonah who is still sleeping. Sleeping and sleeping. And as we know, the verses progress. Jonah understood that it was God that was calling him from his sleep. Left and right slaps. No. He said, unless you throw me into this ocean, this tempest will not stop. He knew that they had to toss him out. They said in verse 14, says, wherefore they cried unto the Lord and said, we beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon us innocent blood, for thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased. Seeing this man struggle, they also started accepting Christ. But the one who has to preach Christ is still sleeping, right? During this pandemic, I think there are so many of them who have accepted Christ, but the ones who know Christ are still sleeping, thinking for good days to come in this horrible world. It says in verse 15, so they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice unto the Lord and made vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. No one bothered to share God's word. God kept calling us, share my word. Jesus has to come, share. No one batted an eye. Pandemic came, all of a sudden, something happened. That's what we're going to read in chapter 2 of Jonah. If you have some Bibles, it's even written there, Jonah's prayer. The second type of Jonah that I want to talk to you about is praying Jonah. Then Jonah prayed, Jonah chapter 2 verse 1. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish belly. Most of the time this is the problem with our lives. Only when problem comes, so we become holy. Only when problem comes, Bible becomes your only book that you read. YouTube is, you watch all the, you know, Christian songs and sermons only when you're sad. Only when you're hit really bad, that's when you remember God. Jonah is no different. God wakes him from his sleep, and now where he's going? To a very horrible place. I think the 6 months would have been a rough time for many, right? I think the first 2 months I never even came out of home. Whatever was sold nearby, for that 1 hour we had to buy and eat. No complaints. Why? Only that is available. You cannot get your chicken biryani or whatever you name it, you can't get it. I think the first 2 months was very strict. My area, everywhere barricades were put. Literally couldn't even go out. Right? Only when problem comes, suddenly we start becoming holy. And that is the second kind of Jonah, a praying Jonah. Where is he praying? In a very horrific place. Inside the belly of a big fish. Smelly and acidic, I do not know if you have seen through the explanations. Such a horrible place to be. There is no electricity there, no power bank there, not even your scriptures in your hand. It says, and said, verse 2, I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice. Understand one thing, no matter how filthy you are, God still loves you. That is the God that we serve. He still loves us. Verse 3, for thou hast cast me into the deep, in the midst of the seas, and the floods compassed me about. All thy billows and thy waves passed over me. Then I said, I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again toward thy holy temple. Can you just see the way that Jonah is speaking? Suddenly he became a poet. Only when struggles come, all of a sudden, all these words come out. Till that time, just do whatever we want to do, right? All of a sudden, Jonah understood, when you're down, the only place that you can go is God. Amen? There's no other place that you can go and save yourself. Everyone knows this. Even doctors here who are there, in the end, what they say? All in God's hands. Even in the pandemic, there are so many people who tried everything and they said, I am done fighting. It's left to God. Right? Jonah understood it when sitting inside the belly of that big fish. Verse 6. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Yet hast thou brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God. When my soul fainteth within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee, into thine holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. This is another phase while we pray. When you are really through tough times, that's when we start making petition to the Lord. Lord, you give me this, I'll give you this. Right? God will give you even if you don't do that. We're not understanding that at all. You think that because you're praying and you're giving your offering, God is blessing you? No. You think because you are doing so much preaching and doing good for the people out there, God is blessing you? No. He loves you, He's giving you. Whether you pray or not, He's going to give you. He's given you health so long. Even if you had COVID-19 and you have recovered, it's God's mercy and grace that you're still alive. We do not understand this concept. We're thinking because we are so good, God loves us. No, He knows we are sinners, chief of chief sinners. Still He loves you. Not because you pray 2 hours, he loves you. He loves you. That's all. Understand that. He will provide for you whether you ask him or not. You have seen your parents at home, right? Do they ask you, this is your menu, this is your menu? They know exactly what you need. At that time, the food is on your table, right? Then how do you expect God, like, only if I do in this format of prayer and I start using Acts form of prayer or the sanctuary form of prayer, God's heart will chill down and He knows He's your Father. He knows who you are. He loves you as you are. And He wants you to change. That's what Jonah did. You know, he went through a really hard time. That sleeping phase. He went into a praying phase. Right now, all are in that phase. We are in the pandemic. Lord, my job should not go. I need salary, half salary, or anything else is okay right now. Right? Food, any menu is fine. I just have to be alive. We are in that phase right now. Most of us, I think, are in this praying phase where we are praying to the Lord, expecting some good to take place. Verse 10 of chapter 2. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. This experience is going to happen very soon for us. We are all in that phase of pandemic. We do not know how long this will go on. Just like how that fish vomited Jonah at the shores of Nineveh to go to God's work, this training phase for everybody will end. We have to get it into the field. Like how in a company when you go, you have only a training phase. It's not going to be forever. This training phase will end and we will have to go. We will have to go. Either you have to choose God or you have to choose the mammon. There's no middle grounds anymore. I believe this pandemic, I don't know about the world, but for Christ believers, it is a training phase. For the ones that were lethargic, the ones that were trying to run away, God shook them, put them in a place and said, listen now, Jesus is going to come soon, you better change. The third kind of Jonah that we might come under is the preaching Jonah. That is chapter 3. It says, and the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. Now God knew that he had him. He had Jonah where he wanted him to be. Sometimes we just read and go away. He was inside the belly of a big fish. Don't know what all was there inside that fish. Even though the stomach was clean, it vomited him. Where? At the shore. Just think, I was always imagining, he just vomited out into the shore. How slimy he would have been. Where did he take the bath? He had to walk for a long time to go and reach anyway. Did he worry about scent or hairstyle? I do not know. Right? That's how you have to be when you're sharing God's word. Money is there or not. People are going to support you or not. People are going to make fun of you or not. I will still go. That is the attitude we have to have. I was just thinking of Jonah. What if people would have seen him so shabby with ugly dress and will they have accepted him? We are not supposed to care. We are doing God's work. Just do it. That's what we have to learn from the life of the preaching Jonah. It says, so Jonah arose and went into Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. I really can't imagine. He's slimy. I don't know if he took bath in that salt water. And with that, he's walking for 3 days. He didn't have his luggage. I don't know what luggage he could have had after being inside the belly of a fish. He's going with nothing, empty hands. What he's going to do? Share God's word. Understand one thing. If you are willing to share God's word, don't worry about finance, who will take you, where they'll take you, how they'll take you, who is going to listen is not your concern. The Holy Spirit will do that for you. Your only concern is, I am ready, Lord, you use me. That is what we need to have an attitude. Verse 4, and Jonah began to enter into a city a day's journey, and he cried and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. He started preaching now. That is where it gets interesting. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them even to the least of them. For the word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his robe from him, and he covered himself with sackcloth and sat in ashes. When was the last time that when you shared God's word, people were filled with the Holy Spirit and they were burning, that they felt that they're not worthy to stand in God's presence? They go and start confessing. When will God's word have that fire experience? If I open a topic of IPL now, I think most of you start talking. We'll have a debate. The debate can end in a fight, right? If you take certain states, I know what will happen. Catches fire just like that forest fire, right? One shot starts burning. You go to his statistics, to his family and his earlier life career, and everything is touched. But when it comes to God, no, it's like this experience. Wet matchbox. Only lighting, nothing is happening. Why? We do not want to talk about it. We are okay to talk about something else. We are okay to put a Facebook post about some actor who has nothing to do with your personal life. He passed away. His murder has so deeply wounded in your heart that you start sharing on your WhatsApp, Instagram, a person came to die for us, nothing is shared. I asked one person some years back, there's one person in a famous movie series, he passed away, there, just pouring out. I asked, what did he do to you? Why are you sharing so much? About, no, he's done awesome. I'm like, what has he done for you? No, it's awesome. Isn't movie entertainment? What did he do for you personally? On a personal note, what did he do for you? I think this year, another basketball player passed away. People are lighting candles. I know some of our church members also were there in that meeting where they gathered. I'm like, when was the last time you gathered for sharing God's word like this? That is the problem. We are striking a matchstick on a wet matchbox. We are ready to share other things as forest fire when it comes to God's word. That is not lighting at all. Why? We don't want to share. Jonah did not worry. He started preaching that the king itself is calling a fast and saying, not only him, it says, verse 8, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn everyone from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. Says in verse 10, and God saw their works and that they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. We have to share God's word in any capacity. I'm telling you, brothers, it's not this stage alone. There are so many ways to share God's word. Do it. Lord will lead. God will provide the finances. How is not your problem? Where is not your problem? Are you willing is the problem. Are you willing to do it? That is the biggest question. Jonah was not willing. God made him shook him. This pandemic is a shaking for the church to make us set right and focus our minds on things that is needed. I believe the ones that are in this pandemic would have understood, you can live with two pairs of clothes for an entire month. You can even eat dal and rice and be alive for the next 1 month. God has shifted our focus. Don't go back again to the life that we have left in the earlier years. The final phase or the final part of Jonah is the fourth chapter. I want to call this the judging Jonah. So we had, you know, the sleeping Jonah, the praying Jonah, the preaching Jonah. Most of us fall in this fourth category, judging Jonah. Chapter 4, verse 1. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry. What made Jonah angry? He preached, people listened. Why should be angry about that? It says, and he prayed unto the Lord and said, I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled unto Tarshish, for I knew that thou art gracious God, merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repentest thee of evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from thee, for it is better for me to die than to live. I heard a person say this. I don't like this person. I literally pray that that person should suffer. Have you prayed? You might not say yes, but I'm pretty sure you would have said at least one word. I have said, right? Tamil, if I say in Tamil, it will be very nice, but I don't want to say it, right? I don't want him to prosper. I will pray for it. We're willing to pray for that person to suffer rather than that person accepting Jesus. Just like Jonah, he preached, people listen. What else do you want? We spend so much time in other people's life that we forget that we are losing our essence in our spiritual walk. When you spend time in other person's life, when you share about them, when you chat about them, when you put thoughts about them, you lose your essence. Never forget that. God has never called out each one of us to expose anything here. He's only asked us to expose the truth in the scriptures that Jesus is going to come. He's not called us to give talks about corruption or this and that. You show me from the Bible where God has told us to expose anything of this. Nowhere. He said only one thing, share the gospel, share the three angels' message, call people for repentance. Everyone needs to repent. Even filthy sinners like the people in Nineveh wanted to repent after hearing God's word. Our only effort is to be to call people for repentance. Nothing else. God had to teach Jonah a lesson. What he did, Jonah was waiting for the destruction of Nineveh. He said, any of these people are going to, no, go away. It says, the verse 6, and the Lord prepared a god and made it come up over Jonah that it might be a shadow over his head to deliver him from his grief. So Jonah was exceedingly glad of the god. Verse 7, and God prepared a worm when the morning rose the next day, and it smote the god that it withered. Verse 8, and it came to pass when the sun did arise, the god prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat upon the head of Jonah that he fainted and wished in himself to die and said, it is better for me to die than to live. Twice he's already said in the chapter, it's better for me to die than to live and see all these things happen. Verse 9, and God said to Jonah, doest thou well to be angry for the God? And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then said the Lord, thou had pity on the God for which thou hast not labored, neither madest it grow, which cameth up in the night and perished in the night. And should I not I spare Nineveh, that great city, wherein are more than 60,000 persons that cannot discern between their right hand and their left hand, and also much cattle? We most of the time pray to God to do our dirty work. We sometimes call God as genie, you know. God, kick this fellow out. God, I don't like this person. God, I don't know this has happened. I want this one to happen. I'm 40 years in the church. I need my stance. I'm here for so many things. I'm good at this. I'm good at this. That person is not better than me. Are you able to understand? This is choking God's ministry in the end times. We are not called to judge people. We are called to work together. In the day of Pentecost, all those people who had differences all came together and they did one thing. That was they prayed and they submitted their lives to the working of the Holy Spirit, and that's when they went to preach. They put all their differences aside. Whatever filth they might have done, they prayed to the Lord through the working of the Holy Spirit. Threw all those things aside. Those judging eyes have been plucked and thrown away. You'll rather be blind and enter the kingdom of God than have the judging eyes and die in hell. I hope that you don't be a part of the judging. I think when you open your Facebook, your blood boils when people write posts about your church, when someone you love is, you know, put into the limelight, how much your heart burns, right? Or there's someone there is preaching and you don't like that person, even if it is a powerful sermon that is allowed by God, you will be deaf to that sermon. That's what the devil wants. Allow God to speak in your life and let your life be a wonderful ministry. God loves even the sinner, because he did not die only for you. He died for everyone. If you look in the story of Daniel, God was not chasing Daniel. God was chasing Nebuchadnezzar. If you look carefully through the chapters of Daniel, God was not chasing Daniel. He knew Daniel will be faithful. He was behind Nebuchadnezzar. He wanted Nebuchadnezzar to change. That's why the dream came to him. We only have to guide those people who are searching God into the flock. Pandemic might end anytime. What kind of a Jonah are you going to be? Are you going to be the one that is sleeping, that even on the second coming, Jesus has to slap you and wake you up? Are you going to be the one that is going to keep praying? Are you going to be the one that is going to preach God's word and let God do the thing? Or are you going to be scorning till the end, cribbing about everything that is happening wrong? You choose which Jonah you want to be. Whatever it is, God will come. He will provide judgment, which is right. Where are we going to stand? Which Jonah are you? You decide. May God bless each one of you. Amen.
On behalf of the church, our sincere thanks to Brother Derek for the wonderful message. As we sing the closing song, during which the offering will be collected, our closing song will be 528. The Lord's our rock, in Him we hide. Shall we all stand?
dawn. O Rock divine, O refuge dear, a shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our help forever near, a shelter in the time.
Let's bow down our heads in prayer. Father, we love you, Lord. We love you that you've given us a Sabbath. We love you that you still love us, Lord. We love you because you are merciful to us, though we are so filthy in our hearts. We love you that you have still chasing us, Lord, though we do not want to be in your presence sometimes. We love you that you wake us up every single day, though we don't deserve it. We love you, Lord, that you are hearing our prayers. We love you, Lord, that you are with our ministry. We love you that you still wink at us, Lord, whenever we make mistakes. You still love us, that you send us Jesus.